It is the College of Communication, so we would hope that the journalism panel is going to be the strength of our game, so to speak. Very simply, look, this is the easiest and the shortest introduction that I'm going to give all day, because if you follow sports at all, these four individuals are household names and trailblazers as writers, broadcasters, investigative journalists. From radio to podcasts, television and long form, and books. You all remember what books are, right? The books are important. We've got you covered in our What's Next in Sports Journalism panel.
Can we do stereo? You're the technology person.
All right, good.
Hello?
Okay.
So do I start?
Yes, sir.
I'm ready. Okay. Now, my name is Bill Littlefield. I host a program called Only a Game for National Public Radio, which is your local public radio station, is right across the street. And if you learned that for the first time, then today wasn't an utter waste, was it? Andrea asked me some months ago if I would moderate this panel. And she said, it's a panel on sports journalism. And I said, okay, that's good, I can do that. And then I got all these notices, and it's not a panel on sports journalism so much as a panel on the future of sports journalism. And
that's why Katie's here.
So you look at... You look at these other three, and what you're looking at here is, if I last the hour, I'm the president of sports journalism, but I'm the guy who, I wrote a bunch of books, and I do radio, and of course, you all know that radio is an everlasting technology because it's very, very dangerous to watch television while you're driving. So I'm happy to be here, and I'm happy to offer whatever I can, but I think that the real future of sports journalism is to my right. And so I'm gonna very briefly tell you a little bit about who these people are, although you don't probably need to have me do that. Kevin Blackstone has won 260 times on Around the Horn.
Should be more.
I'm not sure what that means, but
it's like a Pulitzer, kind of.
It means you were louder, longer than anybody else or something. I don't know what it means. Anyway, it's great. It's good. And Kevin and I spoke, and Don spoke earlier, and you got to listen to Only Game on Saturday. You'll hear a terrific public radio version of Around the Horn. It was kind of fun. Nobody interrupted anybody else.
No mutes.
So they're too polite on public radio. And Don Van Natta is six-time. Is a reporter who's been part of two Pulitzer Prize-winning reporting teams. So he's really the kind of class of the act here, as far as I'm concerned. Your Pulitzer Prizes, that's pretty good. They don't give those out for, nothing. And Katie Nolan, who I hadn't met before, but I read about her. And she's really quite phenomenal. She's hosting a program called Crowd Goes Wild on Fox Sports.
It got canceled.
She was. But the reason it was canceled was Regis Philbin, not you, right?
Sure.
That's my understanding. And you can Google her, and she's terrific. So she is the future of sports journalism, probably. At least to the extent that sports journalism has finally gotten around to the recognition that there are two genders, not just one, and that's very good. So I'm gonna turn this over to you, Don, and we'll just move quickly this way, and you have a little introductory statement or sentence or eight, and then we'll
not really
ask some questions.
But I'm thrilled to be here on this panel and back at Boston University. I graduated from BU in 1986 from the College of Communication, and so it's great to be back here. And I'm an accidental sports writer. I never intended to be a sports writer. I wanted to be a journalist since I was a little boy. And my first job out of BU was at the Miami Herald. I then worked at the New York Times for 16 years. And I started writing these sports books, one called First Off the Tee about presidential golf, and another book about Babe Diedrichsen. And I said, you know, I kind of like this. This is fun. And then one day in 2011, I got a phone call from ESPN, and they said, we'd like you to come work for us. And I thought, that sounds fun. That's pretty cool. I went to Bristol, Connecticut, and toured the campus, and I think my jaw had dropped. I mean, if you're a sports fan, you go to the campus. It's Disney World for sports fans. It's so cool. And I think I hurt myself in negotiations because I was just so gaga walking around. And I've been at ESPN now since 2012 and have been doing sports investigative journalism and having a blast. It's a lot of fun.
Great.
Well, I, too, am an accidental sports journalist. My first job out of college, out of Northwestern, was right here at the Boston Globe. And I was a Cub reporter and for a couple years on the news side. And while doing that, I got recruited to a master's program here at BU, a dual master's degree program between the communications school and the history department. I only have one of those degrees, which is in journalism, which is a little pet peeve I had with BU, but we'll get into that later. Somebody remind me where the administration building is, or the registrar, or whatever. I originally covered news, did investigative stuff, covered economics at the Dallas Morning News, and I was about to leave the Dallas Morning News after about 5 years when the sports editor asked me if I would cover the business of sports, and this was in 1990. And I originally said no, and then he said, well, how about I let you write a column a week because one of our columnists is about to leave. And I called a few friends of mine. They said, you'd be crazy not to do that. You like sports anyway. And I've been doing it ever since. And I did that for 15, 16 years, took a buyout, like so many of us do now, talk about the future of journalism and sports journalism. And started doing a whole bunch of other things, writing in digital space. And one of the things I started doing was teaching at the University of Maryland. And one of my students, Matt Ford, is one of Katie Nolan's producers for a podcast show.
Yeah.
And I didn't teach him anything that he's using to do a podcast. So good for Matt, good for you.
Great for me. Cool, I guess I'll take it. I too was surprised that this was a panel about journalism and I was invited to be on it. it's the first time anyone has called me a journalist before. Also kind of ended up in what I do by accident. I majored in public relations at a prestigious university known as Hofstra. But I grew up here in Massachusetts. I grew up in Framingham. And I left Boston to go to college, which isn't recommended. I don't know why I did that. So I majored in PR. I wanted to go into public relations. Ended up realizing that that's absolutely not what I wanted to do after 16 internships, I think, not paid. And then I graduated at a time when there weren't no jobs. Are jobs back now yet? Because there were no jobs when I graduated, so I moved into the city thinking, I'll find one, and then I didn't. And so I was selling gym memberships at an Equinox, which was fun. Did that for 6 months. And then I moved back home, and I was bartending at the White Horse Tavern. Has anyone ever heard of it? You all probably drink there. I was doing that for a while, and as fun as it was interacting with you all while you're hammered, I wanted to do something during the day to exercise my brain and to keep myself sharp. So I wrote a blog that then turned into daily videos for a website. They paid me a whopping $700 a month to do that. I was grateful because that was my rent, which definitely isn't the case here anymore in Boston, I imagine. That kind of turned into an opportunity to go to New York to continue doing internet videos. And then I got a phone call from Fox saying, hey, we're launching a network. Do you want to come be our Twitter person? Which meant that I would sit on a couch and say, oh, such and such just tweeted this stupid thing. And so I did that for a little while on the lovely show Crowd Goes Wild that you mentioned, RIP. Not Regis. He is still with us, I think. I think. But so that show, I was supposed to sit on the couch and read tweets, and I would sit in production meetings and listen to the men of the panel discuss things together. There was about 17 of them on the panel. And every now and then they would say something just wildly inaccurate. And I've always been a sports fan. And so I would kind of, at first I was like, well, it's not my place to say anything. And then I would eventually started chiming in and being like, that's actually not correct. And after enough of that in production meetings, they moved me to the panel. And then when the show got canceled, I made a pitch for my own show, which I now host. We're on hiatus, but we'll be back May 4th.
Okay, thank you very much.
Was that a long story? It was.
I'm gonna toss a couple of questions out for these folks, and we'll have plenty of time for you to ask how to get a job. One of the big changes, it seems to me, in a fairly recent change in the business that we're all in one way or another, is that so many of the people about whom we used to write are taking advantage of things like the Players Tribune to communicate directly with fans. Derek Jeter, of course, started the Players Tribune, but that's not the only outlet that players have to get their own stories out without having to talk to reporters. Talk to me a little bit about how that's changed things for you, any of you.
It's been a little bit of a change. I guess I'm accustomed to it. Because there was actually, before the Players Tribune, actually like in the mid-late 90s, a similar thing started up. And I remember John Elway was part of it and some other people, and it kind of fell by the wayside. And then after that, some of you may be familiar with the sports blog, which added the element of the Players Tribune to it. And so now you have the Players Tribune. I look at media as being a lens that is created by whoever creates whoever's behind that lens. And so a lot of players are now behind the lens of the Players Tribune, and this is their quote unquote unfiltered message that's getting out to the public, but it's filtered through their lens.
Emphasis on quote unquote.
Or through their agent, their agent's lenses.
Or the ghostwriter,
whoever it is. So I don't feel that it is a threat to what we do in journalism, and surely there's been some news broken on the Players Tribune, but those of us who are in the media still interpret what that news means for the rest of the public, and that role is always going to be there.
It doesn't really affect me that much because people usually don't want to talk to me. Roger Goodell has not ever spoken to me. Despite,
me neither.
I think I'm on four or five, what's that?
Said me neither. I don't think he ever will.
Right, we have that in common. 4 or 5 dozen requests to talk to him. So when you're an investigative reporter, you're used to people not wanting to talk with you. But the fact that the access game is less and less in the hands of sports journalists, and that the players are cutting out sports writers, is definitely one to be concerned about. And they're finding it works. I mean, you know, Twitter, there's so many avenues for athletes, managers, general managers, teams to get their story out without relying on the old gatekeepers. And every year we see less and less of that. So it's definitely a challenge for anybody who does what I try to do, which is dig up the truth that people don't want you to know.
I would say for me it doesn't really affect me as much either, since I'm not really normally contacting athletes for interviews to try to break news. But I will say the interesting thing about the Players Tribune to me that stands out with my background being in PR, or my degree at least, it feels so much like a PR machine, in that it's the point of journalism, and why what you guys and others do that's so important is that they take the information, but they also research it and they cross-check it and they have other sources and they talk to other people to form a full picture, as opposed to an athlete telling their story to a ghostwriter who then takes that and puts it in prettier words and then publishes it. And it feels so much to me like a press release more so than an article. And it's important. One of the biggest challenges, I think, for this industry as a whole going forward is that the line between what's journalism and what isn't is kind of getting blurred with the digital space. And I think it's important for people to continue to know that somebody writing their own story and putting it on a website does not make it 100% true necessarily, and to read everything in that sort of, with a grain of salt, I guess.
I didn't get a chance to see the video that you all saw, but I could hear it backstage. And one of the things that struck me was the extent to which some people at least expect people writing about sports and broadcasting programs about sports to be talking about, to be accessing issues that go way beyond sports, whether it's domestic violence or drug use or concussions in the case of the NFL, CTE, all the rest of it. This is not exactly a new development. This is something people have been doing for some time, but it's a huge change from when I was a kid growing up. When I was a kid, the writers traveled with the ball clubs, most of which were traveling by train. The ball club picked up the tab, and there's a wonderful old story about, now this is, you won't believe it, but even before I was born, when Babe Ruth was playing with the Yankees, there's a wonderful old story about all the writers on the train car, and Babe Ruth suddenly burst through the door at the end of the car with nothing on, rushing through the train, and a moment later a blonde came rushing after him, and she didn't have anything on either except the knife in her hand, and they went rushing past the two writers, and one turned to the other and said, well, there goes another story we won't write. That's not the case these days. Maybe the three of you in turn could talk a little bit about the balance between writing about sports as what the athletes do that astonishes and delights and delights us and brings us back to see them another day, and writing about sports as one segment of society which contains all of the same issues that all the other segments of society contain. I say this because we get emails from people who say, bravo, good work on the concussion stuff. You guys have been after it for 23 years. And we got other emails from people who say, why the hell don't you do some sports stories? Stop, you know, doing the rest of this stuff. So,
yeah, well, I mean, historically, sports was an escape mechanism used to sell media. When newspapers were really competing in the golden age of sports writing in the 1920s, one of the things they found was that they could really sell their product by using sports, in part because sports didn't contain political debate and all the other things were going on in society. And that pretty much stayed true, I would say, until the 1950s, when some scandals started to come about in sports that couldn't be ignored by the media. And then certainly everything changed by the late 1960s and early 1970s, when the Watergate age of journalism really took hold. And so now, thankfully, we don't use sports to hide anything. And we, I think, acknowledge sports as a reflection of society. So, and that's always kind of been my approach to writing columns about sports, which is why I wrote about Will Smith the other day in the context of homicides of black males between the ages of 15 and 34. We pay attention to it because it's Will Smith, and I want people to pay attention to it because there's so many other black males like Will Smith who suffered the same unfortunate fate.
My job at ESPN is to investigate the stories that are literally outside the lines. That's the name of the Bob Lee show. And so that's what I'm paid to do. And that inevitably are stories that those emailers that say to you, why are you talking about concussions? Why are you talking about all this stuff that's not about sports? Don't always like the kinds of stories that I investigate. I spent several months in the fall of 2014 investigating the way Roger Goodell and the NFL handled the Ray Rice domestic violence scandal, and broke the story just a couple days after Roger Goodell went on national television and told the country that Ray Rice lied to him about what happened in that elevator at the casino in Atlantic City. Goodell insisted that it was Rice who lied when in fact Roger Goodell lied about it in that interview, and I did the story 2 days later on ESPN.com. Those are the kinds of stories that I do. They're hard to do. I have an advantage in the sense that I'm not in the locker room. I'm not an access journalist beholden to, if I write something Roger Goodell isn't gonna like, I don't need Roger Goodell next week or next month to sit down and talk to me. Not every sports writer has that advantage, and it's an access sometimes game. There's definitely an appetite and an audience, I think, for those kinds of stories, we have found. The stories that investigate that side of sports. You guys are smarter than we were about the way the world works and about the way sports works. And there's an appetite for us to investigate and dig deeply into really what's the story behind the story. And as you have the rise of the Players Tribune and the rise of access journalism, I think there's even a bigger need and a bigger appetite for the truth-telling kind of journalism that holds public officials to account for what they say and what they do.
Yeah, I hardly ever report on actual like what happens on the field. Because I'm a woman in sports, and it already pisses people off that I talk about sports at all. If I were to start breaking down X's and O's, heads would explode. So I mainly stick to the off-the-field stuff. But the importance of that for me, I think it's because there's barely anything else in the world that we all have in common as much as sports. I mean, other than we all eat food, and we breathe air, and drink water. There really isn't much else. When I meet a person for the first time, I'm like, oh, you're from Baltimore, or are you an Orioles fan? That's my first follow-up is, who are your teams? Side note, people just pick their teams nowadays, just all willy-nilly. We'll talk about that later. Bothers me. But so it's a thing that brings us all together, and usually if you look on Twitter, the five of the trending topics at the moment are sports-related. It's what we all talk about. It's what everyone's thinking about, talking about, it's front of mind. And I think the reason for that is because it used to be where we would go for a release, for fun, for entertainment. When the world gets too stressful, you turn to sports because it's a game. But I think that since that's where the audience is, and that's where we all are, and that's the world that we operate in, that's a great way to start talking about these other issues that aren't on the field, but we can talk about them in that scope and then move on to a bigger conversation. It's the best way to access the audience that you need to access, to say, you know, we are here to talk about sports, and Ray Rice does play football, but also this happened, so let's talk about this. And I think it's been, I like where the focus is shifting to, because I think it's really important to have these conversations.
I want to follow up on something you just said, where you said people's heads would explode if a woman was talking X's and O's. We aren't quite in the same place that we used to be. We've got a woman coaching in the NBA. We've got women doing X's and O's. We've got women doing play-by-play. We've got some women doing analysis and various other things. Talk to me about progress or lack of same, because you're in a better position to do that than perhaps I am.
Well, so it's a little different for me because that's never been my lane or my goal. I am not qualified. It's difficult for me to say that without someone then going, of course you're not, you're a woman. I'm not qualified because that's not what I study, that's not what I want to do. I would say that it's been good to see the progress of women in sports television and sports media. There are a lot of women doing great things. Do I think we need more? Yes. Do I think that there are women... Do I think that there are men on TV who do it that women could do it better than them? Yes.
That's a pretty low bar in some cases.
I know. That's the point. I said the other day, I was at a class at Columbia of sports journalist students, and I said, you know, when we get a woman on TV who sucks and just universally is awful, we'll know that women have made it. Because there are so many men that are just not good, but they get the job. So I think progress is being made. I work in New York. My whole network is in LA, so I don't have as much of an interaction with the actual inner workings of a sports network to be able to say with a lot of authority, but I would say that we're working on it.
Well, and perception is reality. What are we getting to a better place than we used to be in terms of, and not just women, in terms of minorities, representation in all along the line? A lot of press boxes that I first went into when I was first doing this kind of work, there was nobody black in any of those press boxes. At least, are we making progress or are we still stalled?
I was just talking to Torrance. Where's Torrance? Maybe he's still here, maybe he's not. About this very issue. He was asking me about it. So there was a time from the late 1960s, early 70s, up until about 2000, when a lot of minority and women journalism organizations formed and basically tried to cajole mainstream traditional media operations into hiring more people who weren't just white males, because diversity is important. Coming out of the Kerner Commission report in 1968 or whenever it was, that it's important because it helps us cover our society. And there were always goals that they were trying to meet, that they would never meet, but they would get at least make some progress. With the change of things from traditional or mainstream media to digital media and how media economics have changed, people who run, manage, own new media don't have those same relationships, don't seem to care as much about diversity, seem to rest on an idea that they have come up in a colorblind society and therefore this is no longer an issue, and they are wholly, wholly incorrect. And I think the media is headed into a more difficult situation now, in fact, going almost to where it was in the past, and continuing to move forward on this issue. And one thing I'll say about women, at least in TV, sports journalism and TV in general, and I was trying to bite my tongue about this and was unable to when the whole Erin Andrews situation came down, is that women in television news now have been, particularly sports journalism, have been objectified and sexualized. And I think that's very unfortunate. And I think that the Erin Andrews situation is an outgrowth, is an unfortunate outgrowth of that. And that if we portray women in sports journalism as objective, as objects, then I think you run the risk of having what happened to Erin Andrews happen. And if you read Richard Deitz's piece in Sports Illustrated, where he talked to concerns that women in television, in sports TV, have when they're on the road, you get a greater understanding of that. And if you understand that organizations like ESPN have ditched the anchor table and have gone to these walk-around, broad picture, wide lens shots, where the men are in suits and the women are in skirts and teetering on stilettos, you get an understanding of this. And so it's almost as if they're being valued for more for their appearance than for what's between their ears. And I think that's troubling.
Is that something that is more evident in the industry that you're talking about, or simply something that is unhappily omnipresent?
Well, I think it's omnipresent in television news right now, particularly sports.
But there's the added layer too of in sports journalism, a lot of women, especially like sideline reporters, are around athletes, are around alpha males, are around men that are deemed attractive and what a woman looks for in a man. And so there's this subtle, online it's not subtle, but there's this narrative that the woman took the job so she could be closer to attractive men at the peak of their physical prime that have a lot of money because they just want to sleep with them and then marry them, and that's the only reason that they have the job. So I agree that it's in a lot of news. I would say television news, most women, you know, the being objectified like you're speaking about, but in sports journalism there's this extra added layer that it's the woman's fault because she's a predator, that she wants, she's a gold digger, and that's why she's working in sports. Because women couldn't possibly like sports, they just want to be around attractive men who look good in tight pants and play the football, right. Is that what it, the football?
Yes.
And I'll just throw this anecdote in there, which is kind of an aside, kind of related, but some of you may have read about the assistant basketball coach that got fired out at Cal Berkeley. Apparently for propositioning a female reporter. The female reporter also lost her job.
For being propositioned, or?
Well, we shouldn't have those elements of provocation. We shouldn't be, she was asking for it.
I see.
I'm being sarcastic, she wasn't right. asking for it.
Right, and also social media has made it so much more intense, right? Katie, I mean, you can speak to that. Your social media, I'm sure your replies on Twitter, right, blow up every single time you say anything provocative, right?
Yes, or if I say, hey, having pizza for lunch. Not very provocative, but like, maybe have a salad. The internet is not, I don't think I'm the first to say the internet's not really a safe place for women. Women in sports, this is a narrative that we talk about a lot, so I don't think you need me to explain it to you, but the majority of the audience in sports, the vocal majority, I would say, is male. And especially in what I do, which is, you know, give my opinion and talk about how I feel and what I think about sports and sports-related issues, there's an overwhelming internet reaction of, please stop doing that, shut up. And that's me being very nice. That's not what they say. But the reaction is like, please stop talking. Just stop talking. With various other short words sprinkled in there that start with, you know, a C or a B. And so it's not a lovely, welcoming place. I'm grateful for the fact that I have a number of female mentors in the industry that have come before me, like Michelle Beadle and Rachel Nichols, that will tell me to not, you know, read those sort of things or engage with those types of people, because you have to realize that by doing so, you give them a voice and you make other people think, oh, well, she hears this all the time, so I'll just be one of a couple thousand in her mentions. Whereas if that person felt like they were the only one acting completely out of line, they might think about it and not do it. So it's been a struggle for me, because I like to yell at people who do that to me, and I sort of have to bite my tongue and not say anything, because, you know, just let them have their fun. But it's, yeah, I don't know what the solution is for making it a more welcoming place for a woman to share her opinion.
We're going to get to the opportunity for you to ask questions as well, but one other issue that I want to bring up, since we've been talking about women in the industry, I want to talk about women's sports a little bit. We're doing a story this week, the run on Saturday and Only a Game, about the fact that women are still paid less than men to do the same job. The day has just passed, or is it today? I think it's today that a woman would have to work all the way through the previous year and then to April 15th in order to make what a man had made by December 31st.
It's good for tax purposes.
It's great for tax purposes. No, it's not. It screws the accountant up utterly. We were doing a couple different stories. For example, the four major tennis tournaments finally, actually relatively recently, reached the point where they all pay the equal prize money to the man who wins and the woman who wins. On the other hand, the national women's soccer women's team is suing the federation because they are underpaying the women as compared to the men. The WNBA, which many people for a long time regarded as hopelessly weak in terms of its ability to support itself, wouldn't possibly have even been able to exist without help from the NBA, is actually drawing about 7,500 people a game and actually making some money, but the people running it are still telling the players, no, we can't possibly afford to pay you any more than we are, and so they go to Russia and China and play and make a lot more money playing basketball there. And the beat goes on in golf and in lots of other sports as well. There's two theories on this. One is women shouldn't be paid as much as men. Women athletes shouldn't be paid as much as male athletes because they don't generate as much money by selling tickets and television rights and all the rest. The other theory is women don't generate as much interest because the media doesn't cover them as well as they should, given the quality of the competition and athletic achievement. So let's take that one on for a minute.
The media doesn't cover women's sports nearly as much as we should. I'm fascinated by women's sports. I wrote a book about Babe Diedrichson Zaharias, the greatest woman athlete of the 20th century, and I can tell you from experience, it didn't sell many copies. So there's not that much interest in the greatest woman athlete of the 20th century. it's going to start with the media. The only way the revenue dollars are going to flow is if there's more and more WNBA coverage of women's professional sports, women's collegiate sports, and that's how you're going to get at least go and move in the right direction. But it's going to be a long, slow slog, I think, to be really realistic and honest about it. We're talking decades, I think, before we ever see a level playing field between male and female athletes, if ever.
My favorite statistic, by the way, that we uncovered in this story that we're doing for Saturday, the men's teams at the NCAA basketball tournament make approximately $1.6 million each time they win a game. The money goes back to the conference and to the other teams in the conference. The women's teams, even if they go undefeated and win four championships in a row, make nothing. $0 go back to the university and the conferences, which is astonishing to me. I mean, you might be able to make a commercial argument, as Andrew Zimbalist has suggested out at Smith College, you might be able to make a commercial argument that the men generate more money, so they ought to get more, and the women should get less. But how do you make the argument that they shouldn't get anything? It's quite remarkable. So, sorry.
No, it's true. There's a lot to be said about that. But you know, it's the market forces. There's a I think it's Cheryl Cooksey. USC has just done an update. Or did an update to a study that she did some time ago about the amount of television coverage that women's sports get on television versus men, and basically makes the argument that that there's a lot of evidence that suggests, particularly when you look at something like the Women's World Cup, that women are deserving of far more coverage than they get, because of there is evidence that if you put it on, people will watch. And therefore, if you put it on and people watch, the advertising dollars will come, and they will be, they should be justifiably remunerated. It's a tough deal. In the case of the soccer situation, there's no question that the women should be paid far more equitably than they are. If you just go on the fairness tab, they should be paid more than the men,
right?
So that's a real issue. When women in this country make, what, 78, 79 cents on the dollar to what men make during the same job, but the women in soccer are making 38 cents on the dollar, that's got to be fixed. That's obscene. And the other sports is just, you know, it's just difficult. Sports is a masculine world. And as you just pointed out, 17 guys in the room making decisions, and then you sitting over in the corner. There need to be more women in management situations in media as well. And we also need to be concerned about the what I call the bantustization of women's sports, when you take the coverage and you put it on just on ESPNW as opposed to on the main page at ESPN, or you put documentaries about women in sports on a particular channel as opposed to rotating it with all the other shows. And so people get, women's sports become distant for them and not something that they are able to consume just as easily.
It's a tough topic because there's, like you said, so many layers to the problem. So, you know, to the issue of, you know, some of it is a business that if you generate more revenue, you're going to make more money and that's how you get paid more. But there, I don't think there's a person in this room who didn't watch the Women's World Cup last year. I mean, that was huge and it was amazing and it was really fun to watch and we dominated, which was really sweet. For me, it's tough because, like you said, the people making decisions at my network are not, they don't really look like me. They don't make decisions with me in mind. And so, you know, I try to cover, we did a lot of Women's World Cup stuff for my show, but I get 22 minutes a week, and I am being told I have to cover this sport because we have the rights to it, and this sport because we have the rights to it. And so I'm very handcuffed in what I can and can't talk about sports-wise. But at the same time, I am not the only program on sports television. By a long shot, there are ones that people watch. And so, like, if we're talking about women's sports more, just naturally you'll watch. I mean, there's this narrative in your mind when you think women's sports, you immediately think it's not as good as men's sports, because that's just what you've been taught. That's what you've been conditioned, is that, well, if it was, it would be on TV. Well, so if we put it on TV and we start talking about it, and we talk about storylines and we talk about player names, so that you actually recognize someone when you turn on the TV, then you'll stick around and watch it just because there's nothing else on. How many times have you been flipping through TV? Like, how many times can you watch Chopped? A lot. But you can't, you should, there's other stuff. And so if I turned on TV and there was a women's basketball game on, I was like, oh, I know who that is because I saw that story on her this morning on SportsCenter. We just don't have that. We're not having the conversation about the athletes the way we do have the millions of conversations about LeBron. So maybe we could take like one story about a tweet LeBron sent and we just skip that story and instead we talk about a female athlete and get people interested in the sport. I think that is one of the things that is really, would really help this. But like you said, it's going to be a long process.
But a necessary one.
Yes.
And wouldn't it be fine if it started gathering momentum today? That would be lovely. You should all go out and tweet about it. Yes. Now, this will be interesting because I just pressed a button and everything went away.
It's the likes page.
Make it come back.
I put them all on the likes
page. There you go.
There we go. That's excellent. I won't touch anything. Have you all seen that Lewis Black thing where he tries to deal with one of these? Do you know what I'm talking about? You know who Lewis Black is? All right. When you have a minute, Google Lewis Black trying to deal with an iPad, right? And it's wonderful. It's 8 minutes of wonderful entertainment. Anyway, do you think the rise in women's sports makes the sports world more welcoming for women in general? That's great, because it follows right up from what we've been talking about. Do you want to start with that?
Yeah, I would say yes, just because you're exposed to them more. Now when you turn on TV and you see a woman, I can't tell you how many times I hear, you're a unicorn. No, I'm not. There's so many of me, women that love sports. You just haven't made us feel very welcome here, and so we pipe down. So I think, yeah, if women's sports are getting more coverage, I think women will feel more comfortable coming forward and they'll feel more welcome in this space as opposed to the way they may feel now.
Maybe one of us can talk about this, probably not me, because I work for public radio, and so we have none of the kind of pressure that I'm about to talk about. But this is a question about whether there is pressure to break news first rather than wait to get the whole story.
I'm out.
Yeah, absolutely. There's pressure to break news always, 24/7. But there's also pressure to get it right. And that's always the dilemma is, you know, I heard something from one source. Should I tweet it out because I'm worried that seven of my other competitors have also heard it? Or should I get a second source to confirm it? And with social media now and so many reporters breaking news on Twitter, it's even more challenging than it was 5 years ago. I don't have that problem most of the time. There have been some running stories that I've been on where there is intense pressure on me to break the story, but I do more long-form stories that take several months. The challenge is really great. When you're given 3 months by your bosses and they let you travel all over the country to do a story, you better get every single fact right. And so that's a different kind of challenge. But absolutely, there's incredible competitive pressures to be first. And if you're not right, people rarely remember the scoop if it's right. They're going to remember the scoop you have if it's wrong. We used to call it at the New York Times the eternal exclusive. If you do an exclusive that nobody else matches and it's just yours and it's wrong, people are going to remember it.
Dewey beats Truman.
That's right. And, you know, more recently, and the updated version is, how many major news organizations pronounced Gabby Giffords no longer with us?
NPR among them.
Yeah. So the speed crunch is more now, because it used to be you wanted to be first in the morning. Now it's you want to be first in the next 5 minutes. And I just don't know how you verify some things in just a couple of minutes when you hear it. You can't. And you have to fight that you have to fight the temptation that just because you see it in social media, that it's right.
Do you think that phenomenon that you've just described has changed the standards that people operate under? I mean, I can put something out there, right? I mean, if I knew how to operate this, I could put something out right now. I wouldn't have to, not only would I not have to wait for an editor, I wouldn't have to wait for the next edition of the paper. I wouldn't have to wait until it was, you know, my commentary spot tomorrow morning, whatever it might be. I could do it instantly. Has that changed?
I think the standards. Yeah, I think it has. A media writer at the Washington Post a few years ago, and there was some story that generated this discussion, began to argue that things are better off now, and that sometimes it's okay if you're wrong, because in digital space you can correct it immediately. But I think it failed to take into account what you just mentioned, which is basically that all we have is our credibility. And once our credibility begins to erode, look, as journalists in the media, we're already like last on the totem pole when it comes to respect in this country. And I hear that all the time, because the other person in my house is a pharmacist and they're at the top. Uh-huh. Right? So, right. And Congress, are they below us?
I think so. I think Congress is
okay,
still
good.
Below
us. We got them.
Big year for us.
Yeah. We got them. So I think it has changed some standards, and that's something we have to fight.
This is interesting, too. As sports fans and journalists, sports fans / journalists, assuming we're all not only journalists but also still fans, is it difficult to remove your bias when covering your favorite team or athlete? I used to be a fan in a very different way than I am now. And it's partly because I went into locker rooms and clubhouses and talked to general managers and coaches and various other people, and two things happened. One is that I discovered some great people on teams that I didn't used to like. And the other is that I discovered some jerks on the teams that I used to like. And so that makes it really hard to be, I mean, the Red Sox employed a pitcher some years ago who beat up his wife in a motel room, and the reporters called the Red Sox front office and said, what's the story? And the Red Sox front office said, he won't miss a start. That was how they responded to a domestic abuse story. Well, it's very hard to root for that guy, and very hard to root for that front office when that's the way they handle a story like that. I find that I'm very happy rooting for FC Barcelona, the soccer team, partly because they almost always win. This was a bad week that they had this week, but they almost always win. They play beautiful soccer, and I don't see the Spanish papers, so I don't read about all the stuff that my favorite players might have done off the field. So I'm very happy rooting for Barcelona, but I don't really have a rooting interest in teams. I root for players. I root for great guys that I've met, especially if they're recovering addicts, recovering alcoholics. I'm with them. I root for them to hang in there and get it all right for the rest of their lives, because they have been through amazing struggles. But not so much for teams. I root for the story. You know, I wanted the Warriors to win that 73rd game. That's a good story. But it's not, so the bias, I don't really have a team or athlete bias anymore. I don't know about the rest of you.
I'm still 100% biased towards any and every team in Washington, D.C., because that's where I'm from. I am biased, obviously, towards my alma mater and my graduate school alma mater, BU. I always root for them, the Bean Pot and NHL hockey. NCAA hockey.
It's a mistake that's understandable given the quality of hockey played here and the number of people who go right to the NHL.
One of the finest coaches I think I've ever interviewed, and it was over the phone, was Jack Parker 1 year. I thought he was remarkable. People ask all the time if covering sports has soured my fanaticism. It hasn't, but I must admit I am sometimes conflicted. I am extremely conflicted now. I find myself more and more conflicted enjoying my favorite sport, which is NFL football, just because I know that I am witnessing people potentially killing themselves or certainly shortening their lives. I am conflicted watching college football and college basketball because I know that it is an immoral and unethical economic arrangement, and I'm still suckered into it. But as far as teams are concerned, how many Red Sox fans in here? Well, let me tell you something. I'm having a hard time taking your boy Jonathan Papelbon about right now. All right. I do hope he saves every game that he goes out for. But if he touches my boy B Harp one more time, I may have to go in the clubhouse.
I will completely agree with everything you just said. I was the same way that it's like college sports I never had much of a connection to, just, you know, being from here where we don't have college football, really. I mean, you do, but you don't. And so the college sports are difficult for me to watch football same way. I'm lucky in that I don't have to hide my bias, so when a story like Deflategate comes out, I can go on TV and say that it was absolutely bullshit. Because it was... low-hanging fruit for applause. But I will say, too, that, you know, where I used to hate the Yankees and hate everything about the Yankees, because that's how you're raised to be here, you know, I don't hate any team anymore, because it's, first of all, it doesn't make sense for my job to, hey, we got Jeter, do we want to talk to him? No. Like, of course we do. I have to talk to him. And it doesn't make any sense to hate people and teams, and also I've started to like have secondary teams that I like because of the way they are, or because of the way they operate, or because of people I've met on their teams that are good. So like I'll root for the Spurs and I'll root for the Warriors because I interviewed Steve Kerr and he was amazing, and I like what he's doing with his team, and I like the way the Spurs play basketball. And so,
and they're in the Western Conference, so you don't have to worry about it.
Well, yeah. He's really breaking down my argument here. I was trying to look like the pinnacle of my, you know, of unbiasedness. But no, yeah, they just aren't. They don't compete with us. That's the end of what I was saying.
I try to check my bias at the door for every story. But, you know, I did a story in September that some of you may be aware of about Deflategate and Spygate and the connection there. A lot of Patriots fans hated it. And thought that I was a Patriot hater. I'm not a Patriot hater. I did that story because I wanted to try to explain to sports fans why Roger Goodell was prosecuting Tom Brady over a few allegedly deflated footballs in one half of one game. And we found out it had a lot to do with stuff that happened years ago that had nothing to do with deflated footballs. But the reaction in New England was, Vannata, you hate the Patriots. No, I don't. That was the story that we set out to do, and I was really struck by the fact that a lot of Patriots fans didn't read the part of the story. It was about 10,000 words about Roger Goodell. Like, you guys, Patriots fans, were so angry at Roger Goodell for what he did on Deflategate. Well, there's a lot of stuff there about Roger Goodell and the way he just does business, and nobody commented on that. I think everybody just read the part about the Spygate era and that being dredged up again, which was completely understandable. But I will say, as an NFL fan, I'm a diehard NFL fan. That's my favorite sport since I was a kid. As I've learned more about the way the NFL works from the inside, the real underbelly of it, I find it harder to watch on Sunday. I still do. But it's less enjoyable. The more I know about the inner machinations of the NFL, and certainly concussions and the health and safety record of the league and just how obscene it is, it's harder and harder each Sunday to get excited about watching.
I'll just say this. Anybody read the book or see the movie Seabiscuit? You remember?
Aquarius.
So, well, there's a scene when Seabiscuit is running the ultimate race, right? And William Knack, the great sports writer, is seen in the Press Tribune, and he's like, and he's getting caught up, and he's cheering for Seabiscuit. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Well, I don't know, 6 or 7 years ago, the horse Rachel Alexandra, I don't even remember, she was undefeated, and she ran I can't remember if it was in the Breeders' Cup or whatever it was, but she ran against a field of all male horses when she was undefeated. And a lot of people were there covering that, and I was there. And as the announcer's calling it, he's, you know, so-and-so's in the lead, so-and-so is second, and Rachel Alexandra is last, and she comes to the first turn. So-and-so is first, so-and-so is second, and Rachel Alexandra is last. They get on the back stretch. So-and-so is first, and so-and-so is second, and Rachel Alexandra has moved up to fifth, and she's moved up to third. And I'm telling you, we're in that press box, and forget that phrase about no cheering in the press box. Everybody was cheering for Rachel Alexandra. We're standing, we're like, go, go, go. And I don't know if you remember, but she lost by a nose, literally, a nostril. And afterwards, I can't remember who the jockey was, but he was in tears in the press conference because he felt that he had let her down. So, yeah, I'm biased.
I think it's always a good practice to end with a good story, and that was a great story. So thank you very much. Been a pleasure to be here.
Now we know why there's the second mic. Well, I thank you. You guys could go on and on, but I cannot let you leave without asking one essential question to each of you. And that would be, we cannot forget who our audience is here. So, from each of your individual vantage points and your levels of experience, what advice would you give to those who want to break into this wacky business that we have all chosen to make our life's calling? You have to go first.
I'm not sure my advice will be of any use. I was a teacher for 42 years. And so for a long period of time, my work in this field, I was doing in addition to teaching, either full-time or part-time. I stumbled into this when I was first living in Boston in the 70s. I was playing on a softball team in Brookline, where I lived in a rent-controlled apartment that cost me $68 a month.
Oh, my God.
And a guy came up from the local paper to our softball game, and he said, hey, I need somebody to do a human interest story about the softball team. And the captain of the team said, yeah, I'll do it. And then at some point later in the evening, it occurred to him that he was illiterate and couldn't do it. And so he came up to me and he said, you went to college, why don't you do it? So I wrote a little column for this local paper and the guy liked it. And I said, can I write about other stuff? And he said, you can review movies, you can do whatever you want. So I did movies, I wrote about education, I wrote about politics, but I also did this little sports column, and that was the one that caught on. That was the one that he liked best. So then I started sending those columns to public radio station just because I liked the public radio station, and eventually talked my way into doing commentaries for them and for NPR, and then eventually in 1993 we put Only a Game together. And I don't think that's the route into this business at all. It's this nutty way to find a, you know, because I was teaching the whole time. I painted houses for a while. I delivered phone books too, but that wasn't very interesting. But the only piece of advice that I can possibly give is really two-part. One is, if you find some place that you'd like to work, hang around. Go there. Tell them you'll do stuff. Everything. You know, get coffee. One thing I learned to do when I first started the radio station was I learned how to cut tape, which in those days was tape on reel-to-reel tape recorders that you cut with a razor blade and then pasted together to take out your mistakes. Be willing to do all that, you know, scut work, and then hang around, and then somebody will get sick and you'll get the job. So that's one way. But the main thing that I would say, I'd just pass along a piece of advice that Tim Horgan used to give. He was a columnist for the Boston Herald years ago, and he was speaking to a gathering similar to this, and he said to the group, "Why do you want to be sports writers?" And everybody raised their hand with the same answer, and they all said, "We love sports." And he said, "That's the wrong answer. You got to love writing." And even if the writing is in 14-bit, what the hell is a tweet anyway?
140 characters.
40 characters. 40, whatever the hell it is.
14-bit.
So we were going to do this. I was going to ask another question from this, but it broke. It broke. It went black. I didn't touch it. Anyway, writing is writing. And if you care about writing and you really want to do it and it moves you and it makes you feel like you've completed something, it makes you feel like you've built something that wasn't there before you built it, that's the passion that keeps people like me in this kind of a job. And if I wasn't writing about sports, I'd be writing about something else. And that's just who I am. And happily, I figured that out a long time ago, that was something that was going to give me a lot of satisfaction and make me feel like I was doing something worthwhile. So that's the main thing. And if you can tap into that, and if that's what it's about for you, great. You'll find somewhere to do it, and probably by hanging around. And your 16 unpaid internships notwithstanding, that's still not a bad way to go. So that's what I got.
Yeah, my advice is very simple. It's all about reps. It's just reps. That's the secret of life. If you do something enough, work at it hard enough, keep doing it over and over and over again, you're going to get better at it than everybody else. And somebody told me when I was very young, I was just a kid reporter at the Miami Herald, that journalism is a test of will. And it really is. It's how badly you want it. And so I would advise you guys to write every day, do interviews if you can every day. Whatever the tool set is that you want to be best at, do it as much as you can. And if you keep at it and you want it badly enough, you'll get the opportunity to do it. Because most people are not going to work as hard. If you really want it, most people are not going to work as hard as you at it. And you just keep doing it. It's reps.
I'll add to that and say, start doing it right now. Because you guys are in a position that that's very unique in this time in history, that you all have portals to the rest of the world that sit on your lap. And so you can make a YouTube video today. You can write an article today. You can start a blog today. And I know for me and for a lot of other people, you have that moment where you're like, I'm going to start a blog. I'm doing it. And you write one post, and then you don't ever write on it again. And then that one post, people see it, and they're like, I like this kid. I like the way he writes. Let me see what else he wrote. And you have nothing else to show for it. And so reps and consistency, and just start making what you want to make now, because that's what I did, and I didn't even realize at the time how valuable it was going to be for me. I mean, I know I came out of nowhere, and overnight success is a word that people use a lot when they talk about me. First of all, not that successful yet, but second of all, overnight just means I didn't sleep. I mean, I was doing 5 videos every week from my apartment. I was researching them. I was writing jokes. I was filming them. I taught myself how to use a green screen. I taught myself how to use editing software by watching YouTube videos that were edited with editing software about how to edit with edit software. I just learned and I consumed as much as I could, and then I put out as much as I could. And so when someone found one video of mine that they liked and they clicked on something on my channel to see what else I had, there were hundreds of other videos. And so each one didn't have to be perfect, but they knew, oh, she works, and she's been doing this, and she knows how to do this. And they're not amazing, but they're fine enough. And she has enough of them that there's something we can do. And it was also really helpful for me in that now, people ask me a lot, how did you get a job sharing your opinion, and say, how do you get away with saying whatever you feel like saying on television at the moment? A, I'm super lucky because that's a cool job. But B, I always made everything in my own voice. And finding your voice is really difficult, and I hate when people say, go find your voice, because it's not that simple. It's reps. Just keep doing things, and you'll look back at your body of work and say, oh, that's my voice. And so I'll never get a job offer to be, you know, a very serious reporter who does very serious things, because I've never put that out there for myself. I've always been on more on the comedy side of things and a sports fan at the heart of it. And so I was, without realizing, basically able to set myself up to get the kinds of jobs that I would want just by creating. So these are a lot of words I'm saying, but just start creating now because you can. And you don't have to wait for that job at a small local market so that you can work your way up through the... Just go on YouTube. You can put real stupid stuff on there. Nobody checks. It's like Wikipedia. Just go on YouTube and just start making things, like now. Or live blog. What's a blog? Blogger. Is that still a thing? Yeah. Live journal? Get a MySpace. It'll work.
That's all better advice than I gave you.
It's not true at all.
Yeah, no, my advice would have been good in, say, 1971. But yours is better now. Yours is better now.
Your advice is perfect right now. I second everything everybody said. Writing, do it. Where do you do it? I tell every freshman coming into the University of Maryland, start a blog now. I don't care what it's about. I don't care how you configure it. Just start it, to get yourself in the practice of doing that. And also because this is an era of media where you're going to be expected to be entrepreneurial, just for your own survival to begin with. There are some juniors at the University of Maryland who, when they got there as freshmen, became friends and started their own sports website. And last year they monetized it. They got ads, they got t-shirts, caps. They're even paying people to work for them. They're juniors. And this helps you get reps. Reps are so important. Did you see the 30 for 30 on Reggie Miller and the Knicks? And you see that? One year that the Pacers were really good with Reggie Miller. I happened to be at one of their playoff series, and I was at the arena early, and I was just kind of walking around, looking around. I looked down on the floor, and Reggie Miller was like the only player out there, first one out for warm-ups. And he was standing at the three-point line, and he had a guy feeding him the basketball. And he was just doing this move where he would take a jab step, catch the ball, and when he took his foot back, he created space between him and whoever the defender was. Whap, three-pointer, boom, boom. Whap, three-pointer, boom, boom. Whap, three-pointer. So comes game time. He does that. Hand in his face, doesn't matter. Repetition, you got it right. And the last thing I would say is that somewhere in the home I grew up with, as you know, mothers, they collect everything that you do. Thank you so much, Mom. There's a box of letters that I received from newspapers to whom I applied for internships. One of the letters is from the Dallas Morning News. No thank you. I worked for them for 20 years. Another one is from the Washington Post, my hometown newspaper, which I used to deliver. No thank you. I've since turned down jobs from them, and now I'm writing an occasional column for them and doing some videos. So don't take no as a final answer. It's just part of the process. It's a speed bump in the road to whatever it is you're going to do. And don't be afraid to knock on a door more than twice, call more than twice, email more than twice. Let them know you exist. Let them know you're still interested. Get your stuff in front of them. Push it, push it, push it. It's okay to be a pest.
And when I was a kid, starting I think around the age of 7, I wrote a letter every week to Sports Illustrated because my dream was to be published by Sports Illustrated. And I'd get one of those little cards. Did you ever write a letter to Sports Illustrated? You got a card that said, thank you for your letter, but we're not going to publish it. And I have a box of them. I think there's 700 of them at home. Never got published. And then when my first book came out in 2003, first off the tee, I got a phone call from an editor at Sports Illustrated and said, we're excerpting your book in the magazine. And that was probably one of the best days of my life. It's reps. It's test of
will. You
should
have sent a thing back like, thank you. I'm not right. Publishing your letter.
Yeah. Not
or sent the box back.
I want to put a P on this with another word. It begins with P, and that is, doesn't matter what generation you're in, doesn't matter what medium you're in, passion. Nothing replaces passion. For whatever it is, if it turns out to be journalism, whatever the line of work that you choose to be your own, if you have passion for it and you accept no for an answer and you get the reps and you do it on whatever medium it is, you will succeed. So I want everybody to take that away as well. Huge thanks. Every one of these our guests, Bill, first of all, Bill's got a show tomorrow. So we came out of production to do this, and we are greatly appreciative. Katie in from New York, Kevin from Washington, Don from Florida. So huge thank yous. And our final piece of business is there will be a brief meet and greet with our guests. I don't know if you can stay or not.
I'm afraid I can't.
All right, you can't. But
I'm right across the street, so y'all come over anytime you like.
That's right.
They're like, there's
around.
A radio.
But we'll have a brief meet and greet at the Career Cafe for a short period of time. And it is the end of the conference. It's been an amazing day. A couple quick thank yous. Today would not be possible without the College of Communication. Dean Tom Fiedler has hung in there the whole day. We had a terrific partnership. There can be a symbiosis between athletics and academics with the BU Athletic Department, Drew Marichello and his terrific staff, obviously the terrific staff of Comm. And there's one other person I have to single out. Long day, can't speak very much. There's a saying that no one is indispensable. Today does not happen without Professor Susan Walker of See, you're off the clock. So she is a mentor. She is a role model, mother of three. And she is someone who feels so strongly about making the journalism department at BU the best in the country. So doesn't happen without you. Thank you. And on that note, we have crossed the finish line of the first ever Boston University Sports Communication Summit. Enjoy the Red Sox at home, the Celtics in the playoffs, and of course, Marathon Monday. Thank you all for coming.